Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of HDE Podcast. I'm your host, Ron Sosa. For those who have just tuned in and listened to me for the very first time, congratulations, you have just found my logbook. In all honesty, anywhere I tend to post videos and audios tend to be kind of my view of a logbook or a digital format of a logbook. You are going to be listening to pretty much anything I tend to enjoy, and that's usually contract work, robotics, hardware, software, and even a little bit of web development here and there. And if you enjoy those topics, great. If you don't, you're probably going to be bored for what I'm talking to you about. So, yeah. Yeah, if I start talking to you about my projects that tend to include a lot of those stuff, then at least you know anyways. But do stick with me, because I do like to believe I'm actually kind of entertaining. I think I am anyway. Now, for those who have been listening to me from the very beginning and in some regard kind of enjoy my podcast, you probably noticed there's quite a few things that have changed, not just the audio. I'm going to give you a hint. If you're listening to me through the, well, if you're listening to my podcast as an audio, I'm actually recording myself as a video as well. Separate sources, so I'm actually recording the audio and then dubbing the audio on the video, but anyway, you get the idea. Now, the reason why I'm doing this whole new format is I figured, well, if I'm going to go ahead and change all the setup that I have for recording the audio, I might as well try and play around with something different. And I wanted to try and record myself as a video. Now, the reason being is for a couple of reasons, actually, I should say. The first one is that I actually kind of started liking the idea of watching some of the podcasts, like such as Tested, and even the Radio 1, which is kind of the UK radio station. I've been enjoying the fact that they record themselves while they're live on air, or Tested while they're doing their podcast. I like the idea because you can see where I'm at. You can kind of get a better picture as to what's around me when I'm talking to you. And often when I do this podcast, I tend to kind of draw inspiration from what's around me. And I do like the fact that I get to pick things up and show it off on the cam for anybody who actually wants to see what I'm doing. But to be honest, I'm liking the idea that people get to both see what I look like and, more importantly, get to see the room that I'm in, so they're aware the reason why the podcast sounds like this. Hopefully they get the picture. And also, to be honest, and this is the final reason, is that whenever I release a podcast, I always do a video version of the same podcast to release on YouTube. Usually, I should say, it's easy. I just basically stick a static picture on the video and play the audio in the background. And that's fine, but I kind of figured that a lot of people aren't really going to be listening to that, because, you know, to be honest, who goes to listen to my kind of podcast in YouTube if there isn't anything other than just a static image? So I figured I must just record myself and you get to see stuff. And I am hoping to improve the everything, really. One thing that I'm not sure I'm happy about is the location of the camera. I'm not sure if this is a good view for anything, really. I kind of feel like I'm being talked down if you are picturing yourself on the other side of the camera and I'm kind of below it. But it's kind of the best place that I was able to put the camera anyway. So if you do get a chance to look over, do head over to see the video so you can kind of see what I mean. It was kind of hard to try and pick a position, really, because if I could do it behind the monitors. Well, what it is that I've got two big windows in this room. Now, you would think the more light, the better, but actually, with the placements of the light makes a difference. And if basically all the source of the light is coming from one location, it kind of ruins it just whitewashes everything else. I kind of feel like whenever I put the camera on and I put it facing, so the light source in a particular location, everything in the background, because the room is almost all white, it kind of ends up drowning me and making me look a bit weird. So I feel like this is the best place to put it. And I also got a little spotlight on the side, a little LED lamp a studio lamp on the side. It's LED, but it's a studio lamp next to the camera to try and counteract the light that's coming from my other side. So it's kind of weird. I might try and do a view of the office / lab one day, but anyway, enough of that. So yeah, I figured I'd just change a few things. And also, the previous format that I had, the way I kind of did an intro, talked about the stuff that I wanted to talk to you about, I was kind of feeling a little bit, I don't know, I felt like something was missing. For those who aren't aware of what I'm on about, or haven't had a chance to look at my previous episodes, or listen to my previous episodes, I should say, I used to just start everything with a weird kind of cheesy intro, in the hope that you can kind of get an idea of what I'm going to be talking to you about. So, for example, when I talked about, when I did the last episode, which was to do with data logging, I did this weird intro about star date logs, and kind of tried to draw a joke of the fact that, you know, Star Trek, they all start their logs with star date, blah, blah, blah. And I figured, well, you know, they're logging their day, might as well used as an intro, and it was really bad. It really was. It's not a problem now. Now, So I've changed all that, so I'm not really going to be giving you a weird intro. I'm just going to be saying hello and welcome and introduce the podcast to myself, and maybe I might even drop the whole I'm your host for an social thing, because to be honest, if you're listening to my podcast and I'm the only person talking to you, or you're listening to, you probably are going to know who I am anyway. And if you don't, then you probably can go to the show notes and pick it up from there anyway. Anyway, we'll see. I'm kind of enjoying everything right now. I'm enjoying the format and stuff. Now, regards to the audio, the reason why I wanted to spend some more money on that, trying to improve on that, is because, to be honest, the previous setup sucked. I know I mentioned this, it really did. I was actually using a dynamic lapel mic, recording straight to a portable recorder. In fact, it was the Zoom H1, which I have around here in the lab. And it was fine, but the microphone wasn't really made for the kind of setup that I am in now. If you do take a time to look at the YouTube video, you see it's a small room, very kind of echoey. It's not as bad considering that I've got carpet and curtains and stuff like that, but it could be worse. I mean, it definitely was worse before when I was doing recordings on the previous place that I lived in, which was a very echoey room and it was really bad. But the problem is with that microphone, it was picking everything quite evenly. It was picking up my voice, it was picking up the noise of the computer fans, it was picking up the echoes, it was picking up the noise from within the room, and you know, the list goes on and on. The worst thing really was picking up the sounds that was coming from outside, you know, the neighbors and stuff like that. Whenever they were cutting the grass during summer, it was a pain, it really was. Which meant that I always have to try and figure out a time to do the recording, because I was always trying to find the quietest of time to do this podcast, and in all honesty, that's quite difficult on its own anyway, mostly with the fact that I have to do contract work, you know, that's my day job, and whenever a client wants me to do something, I have to stop all the little side projects to make sure I work on there, because that's actually a paying project or paying gig, where with the whole doing a podcast, this is free, you know, personal time kind of thing, all that sort of stuff. But now, it took me a while because I was trying to figure out what microphone to go with. And in all honesty, I'm not an expert in any audio setup. I'm, you know, like most people doing YouTube videos, you sort of learn as you go along, unless you still happens to be your daytime job and you know quite a bit about it, or you're quite, you know, there's various other things. But I personally, I'm not, you know, I'm not a big nerd about audio stuff, and I was kind of trying to figure out what's a good setup, one that gives me enough flexibility in the future whenever I want to do stuff, but at the same time kept things simple because I didn't really want to be spending too much time tweaking settings. For example, I was looking at the option of getting myself a audio mixer with a condenser mic with an XLR output and phantom power and all that sort of setup that I wanted to get. Because I kind of like the idea there was going to be enough settings that I can get to play with, and maybe get some with the compressor effects so I can try and make my voice sound a bit more even right out the bat. And I thought about it and I realized that I'm one of those people who just can't stop playing with settings. I'm going to struggle not to change the sensitivity of the current mic that I have between shows, let alone a mixer with so many different knobs to kind of start tweaking to try and get the right setting every single time. I'm going to be one of those people who's just going to look at it and say, oh, but maybe I can adjust this a little bit more. And I figured I'd just get it out of the way before I start having to kind of deal with devil's advocate with that sort of stuff. So off he went, kind of thing. And I thought, okay, so what about if I just get a microphone with a built-in USB cable, you know, a USB output, I mean. And this is where I got this microphone. So the reviews seemed pretty good, actually. They were saying, like, it's kind of like a studio microphone, and I'm doing the bunny ears for those who are not looking at the video. Yeah, it's supposed to be studio quality. Arguably, though, for the price point, that's a big giveaway that it isn't actually a studio quality microphone. It's as good as you're going to get for that price range. And in all honesty, I've not bought a different set of microphone to do a comparison. I didn't bother doing that. I was trying to make the right choice the first time, because I don't really fancy wasting any money on constantly going between setups. And anyway, it's just, you know, one of those things anyway. So I got this microphone, connected it up, and as soon as I had it all set up, it sounded worse than my previous lapel mic. It was noisier, it barely can pick up my voice. I the default settings were quite low. It was too low. And then I found out something kind of interesting about this microphone, which if I hadn't realized, if I didn't spot this and I didn't see something about it online, I probably would already send this one back and gone for another one. But it turns out that this USB microphone outputs in stereo. But you would think, okay, it's output in stereo, then okay, both channels are going to be playing the same thing, because really it's just one microphone built into the condenser. You know, it's only one condenser. You know, you bought a condenser, you would expect that the sound source would be output in both channels. It turns out to be not the case. One channel is used for the pre-gain of the microphone, and the second channel is the final gain, the post-gain. Is that the right term? So you get the signal, it goes through one amplifier, you get the output of that on one channel, and then goes through the final stage, or the final, yeah, is that gain stage, final gain stage? It's been a while since I've dealt with op-amps and stuff and amplifiers. But yeah, you get the output of both the pre and the post amplifier, and that's what you get from the USB channel. So if you're recording for something like, if you're recording using something like Audacity, you have to make sure you set Audacity to mono. And to be quite honest, I don't know if this is standard between audio between recording devices or in the industry, but whenever you set it to mono, it picks the left channel on a microphone. And when I looked at the user manual for the microphone, that's what they were suggesting. Make sure that it's mono and you select the left channel. So I couldn't really find anywhere on Audacity to change between channels, but I was just happy the fact that it picked the correct one, the left channel. So I'm probably not going to chase that up any further. If anybody have any more information about that, whether the left mono channel is always a standard output, then do let me know. But it's a learning thing. But yeah, so once I figured that out and I started playing with the gain, suddenly, like the moment you went from stereo to mono, the output was impressive. It was great. It was way better than what I had before. And then I was able to up the gain on the microphone, and bam, there we go. You can pick up my voice. It picked up my voice. It wasn't picking up the noise from the computer or the echo of the room. It is picking up the echo of the room, but I'm close enough to the microphone that it isn't as obvious, I don't think, anyway. I'm pretty certain if I was to put acoustic foams in this room, the quality would be even better, but I'm not really going to waste any time or money on that, to be honest. Or at least not until this podcast makes any difference to anybody. But, you know, for my rambles and my logbook shenanigans, then this is good enough for me, I'd say anyway. For the time being, I say. So, yeah, so I did that. But then, to be honest, it wasn't just the fact that it's a better microphone than a lapelled one. It's also the pickup pattern of the condenser that also made a big difference. The dynamic one, as I mentioned originally, that picks up sounds from all around the microphone. And I was I knew different mics had different pickup patterns. I didn't think it was going to make that much of a difference. I figured if the lapel mic was close enough to the source, i.e. my voice, then I can reduce the sensitivity so it's not picking up everything as much. That's fair, but I think you do still need a very good room for that to be a good effect. With the condenser mic, the pickup pattern that I have is basically means that it's very good at picking up sound directly in front of the microphone, but from the sides or the back, it's not so good. It's way. I'll put it on the show notes so you can actually see the bolt. Is it the bolt? The bolt. It's been a while since I've done this. Again, not an audio engineer. I'm an electronic engineer. I don't do much in audio. I'm more of a digital kind of side of things and coding, so do, you know, bear with me when I'm screwing up all these names. Now, so the pickup pattern is cardioid hyper, and I'm sure I screwed the name up on there. So as I said, it's very good at picking up what's in front of it, but the drop-off zone for the sides and the back is quite tight. Because this is a hyper one, it's even better at not picking up sound from the sides, with a little bit of sacrifice of increasing a little bit of sacrifice of actually picking up what's in directly behind it. So you do have to make sure that what's behind the microphone, it's quiet, or at least you're not getting too much of a reflection. In my case, it was perfect. It's not picking up the computer fan, it's not picking up the echo as much in this room, so that's going to work out quite well. And more importantly, it's not picking up the sound from outside the room, so within the house and the outside the neighbor. So basically, I mean, it's a long-winded explanation, but I can finally start recording when I want to start recording. Within reason, of course. If you have somebody outside playing house music, you know, a party outside, then, you know, yeah, you do kind of have to work around that. But for most normal noises, people parking up, people going into their houses, neighbors chatting away, walking the dogs, fine. Not an issue, but perfectly fine. And then with the sound within the house as well, perfectly fine. I can deal with that. So I have a much better chance of have an increased chance of being able to record the podcast versus what I had before. And also means that I'll be able to do my videos as well. So this is kind of a test between that anyway. Anyway, enough about that. I've been talking to you about 40 minutes about audio. I'm sure a lot of you find that kind of annoying. Let me talk about some stuff that I've actually been doing. Something more in topic, I would say. So what I've been up to. So those who've been waiting to hear another episode of mine probably really realized there's been over a month and a half since I released any videos and audio, podcasts. And that's because obviously we've been on holiday, or we've had the Christmas period, we've had the New Year's period. Basically, the good old long holiday from everything. And the thing is, the problem I have is that, and kind of what made this whole suggestion take even longer, I do contract work, and unfortunately whenever I go away on holiday, I have to spend quite a bit of extra time coming back to settle everything back to normal in a stable manner, i.e. I have to chase clients up, I have to let them know that I'm back from holiday, I have to try and get their projects up and running again, I have to kind of speak to clients to remind them that what we still have to do, and meetings after meetings and emails after emails, and usually tends to add up between 2 to 3 weeks in worst case scenario. I mean, I've had it before where it took almost 4 weeks to finally get everything up and running from a particular client because that was a long ongoing project and blah blah blah. So yeah, that took a while, and while I'm doing that, I obviously can't do any podcast, and regardless how good the setup is, I have to, you know, make sure that I focus on that, get that up and running. But yeah, it wasn't too bad though. This time it took longer than I expected, but yeah, I'm back anyway. I'm doing podcast, and we should all be good. But during that time, I actually have had some free time to do some of my own personal stuff, because after all, I did actually go on holiday. I finally got a chance to finish off a project, or start a project that I've been dying to do and finish it off at the same time. And it was the animated Santa Claus. For those who are aware of my YouTube channel, you probably have seen the video on that. During Christmas, I decided to try and animate or create a little animated Santa Claus that sings to you and tells you occasional jokes here and there. I managed to do that because the reason why I finally got around to doing that is because the subscription service that I'm signed up to, which is the Bobport monthly club project subscription that I'm signed up to, he sent out, or Sar from Bobport, sent out a board on November, I think it was, which pretty much had all the electronics that I needed to do the Santa Claus. So I figured, well, I don't have to reinvent the wheel, I can just use the electronics on that rather than trying to spin my own and just focus more on the mechanical stuff, and that's what brought up that chance of doing that. And so the hardest part of that particular project was me trying to try out this new software that I've been dying to use, which is Fusion 360. For those who aren't aware of what Fusion 360 or much about 3D CADs and stuff like that, Fusion 360 is a software you can use to model parts. Now, it's similar to some of the other stuff, such as SolidWorks, 123 Design, which is the same people that do Fusion 360. But the difference is that this is more of a professional tool that you have the chance to also use without having to pay for a license. So they've got a lot of licenses that you can use that allow you to use it for free. So for open source projects, maker projects, hobbyists, students, it's free to use. For small companies such as myself, as long as I'm not making X amount, I think it's like 100,000, something like that, I don't have to pay a license. I can still use the free license to do all my development. So, and even to be honest, and even if I do have to pay a license, the cost of that of Fusion 360 per month, it's a monthly subscription, unfortunately, it's like something like $50 or $60, or maybe even $120. That's still a lot cheaper than SolidWorks is, period. Like with SolidWorks, the cheapest license for a corporation is like something like 10 to 15 grand or something along those lines, and even then it's per seat. So it's insane, and unfortunately, almost all the clients that I deal with, I tend to use, well, not all, but the ones that I do mechanical stuff for, I'm always having to use SolidWorks for that, and it's always been kind of downside, because I always wanted to kind of release some projects, because some clients are happy with me to release some projects as open source, but unfortunately, with SolidWorks being so, well, a pain in my bum, I should say, when it comes to licenses, I can do it justice to release files in SolidWorks and still feel that it's quite open, because yeah, try and get a hobbyist to use SolidWorks without cracking the software. Yeah, there we go. Now, that said, though, with Fusion 360, I've been down to use it because of its licenses, and so this particular project was finally the one that I was able to go ahead and do that with, and I was fairly happy with it, because there were some interesting things about Fusion 360 that I thought was kind of weird, like the way you assemble parts together, the way you make them is a different way to think about it. With SolidWorks, you are adding constraints, so if you want one side of a square to mate to another side of a square, then you basically select those surfaces and they're locked in place in, you know, whichever axis you do it with. With Fusion 360, the concept is the other way around. You have to picture it with the fact that everything's already constrained, so whenever you mate two things, everything's constrained, and you then have to decide what to release. So it's kind of the other way around, kind of the opposite of that. It took a while, because the way they've implemented it is a bit weird in some cases, but once you get your head around it and how the UI works, it was perfect. I went out, it didn't do that bad for me. I just went in there, did what I needed to do, and off we went. It took a little while to get used to the software, but it wasn't too bad though anyway. Now, that said, there was some interesting stuff that I quite enjoyed about the software. The importing tools was good. I'm not a big fan when softwares tend to be quite dependent of cloud, any cloud services altogether. Fusion 360 has a built-in cloud you can use to share with other people and also make changes to the model within the internet or within the web browser. But the software itself that you download, the actual software, is an installer for a computer. And they allow you to work offline, and they also allow you to save the files offline. So you can use the cloud services to share with other projects, but you can also export to a file format that anybody can use, STEP, or even their own proprietary format that you can then reload again on the same software. So I was really happy with that, because you get the choice of being able to use cloud without being stuck with using anything in cloud. So I was, I'm happy with the way they implemented it. And I wish a lot of the cloud services out there had the same, the same beliefs, whoever convinced their sales to go down that route. I wish a lot of people did that. I wish there were a lot more software engineers kind of going, yeah, well, we do that, but then we really should be thinking about this, because you're going to keep people like me. I don't want to be stuck using a cloud services that might one day kind of failed and all that sort of stuff anyway. So anyway, that's another topic for another day. So yeah, finished that. I'm not going to go into too much detail with the animated Santa Claus, because I am hoping to do a dedicated video on that. But basically, it's kind of to break down what makes that Santa Claus anyway. So you got the electronic board from Ballpoint, which is project number 9. It's a board that has a built-in infrared detector, and you can play audio from an SD card, not MP3s, but you can load audio. Just bear that in mind. It's raw binary that you can stick into an SD card, and it can play directly from that. And did have to make some changes to the software, but it wasn't too bad anyway. That said, though, that kind of dealt with the software side of things. I was quite happy with that board, actually, because I don't know whether this was a design feature or if it was just kind of like the way SAR designed things, but the driver for the infrared emitter, which was a MOSFET set up in a open collector, the output of that was routed out to a pin, to connectors, I should say, which means that you can drive other stuff, not just the infrared emitter. And I took advantage of that to drive the motor I needed to, and the motor that I happened to have chosen didn't need anything special, didn't need any H-bridges or anything like that. It was well within the spec of that MOSFET. There were some issues, like, for example, when the infrared is being used to detect things, then you have to make sure that the motor can't be driven with that very brief signal. And then when the software is no longer detecting anything in infrared, i.e. it's playing audio, I did kind of have to make changes to the software so that you actually full wax the motor, which unfortunately also means that the infrared is also on full wax, so it's all on continuously while the motor is running. But it's a compromise, because I didn't really want to make any changes to the board. Hey, to be honest, if I was going to make any changes to the electronics, I might as well just design my own. I can do that quicker than just going through and just trying to bodge some design on that. So, I mean, to be honest, I got loads of development boards laying around in this lab anyway. There was plenty of other ways that I could have done other than just using the board if I had to make any changes. So, yeah, it's one of those things anyway. Because to be honest, the board wasn't that complicated. It's just called an infrared receiver, or transceiver. No, infrared transistor. Is that the right? infrared photoresistor, I think that's the right term, and an infrared emitter all working within the same wavelength, and that gets inputted to the microcontroller, and then the output is then the microcontroller is driving a, I think it's just an audio DAC, and then reading from an SD card. So it, you know, it's stuff that I've done before, just they're not open source. It's kind of annoying, really, but with this particular board, it is all open source. It's open for anybody to make whatever they want to, and you can always just take the design files from that and make your own changes. There is one caveat to the design file, and that is that it was implemented using Ballport's PCB mode, which is a good software. I did enjoy playing with it, as well as the fact that it's using Inkscape to route the tracks. I did find that kind of interesting. And surprisingly comfortable to use, because if you've ever used any vector software to draw stuff, you get what I mean when you try to draw a line and you can really create any curvature you want to, closer to what you actually want to do. So I quite enjoyed it. Now, as I said, I didn't want to make any changes to that, so I was trying to more focus on the mechanical side of things, and there were a few things that I had to do. Like, I had some motors already here from a previous project, the micro robot that I put together, and the motor that I was using was a 3-volt DC brushed motor that was, it was basically had a built-in planetary gear setup, which stepped down the motor down to 50 RPMs, and it was kind of small, quite nice. It's the sort of motors that are used on things like telecommunication filters, you know, when you physically actually try to move a resistor pot rather than having to actually do that digitally. So it's quite cool. And quite cheap as well if you are buying it, if you do want to buy your own, yourself a few of those. So I had that, and I just had to, interesting enough, I actually had to step up the gear ratios from 50 RPM to about 200 RPMs, because the motion I was trying to create on the SoundCloud wouldn't have looked realistic. Okay, I know it wasn't going to look realistic, but it wasn't going to look good. So I needed to step that up and kind of had to use some a couple of spur gears to do that. No, it's not even spur gears, is it? It's just normal gears, just two mating gears. You know what? I'm going to stop talking about the project now, because it's not really that impressive. I will do some videos and I will put it on YouTube if anybody's actually interested in seeing that. I actually did record myself both doing the design to printing and putting together, so it might actually be more interesting for you to see videos of that than me trying to explain it to you on both on the podcast and on the video where I'm just waving my hands. So, hello! Now, that said, what else did I do? Oh, that's it. There was one other thing that I did while I was on my holidays that I've been dying to do for God knows how long now. I finally got the chance to try and play around with genetic algorithms. Now, it's not as impressive as I originally thought when I was trying to learn, get into it. It's one of those things where there was quite a bit of media hype a while back about it, and then kind of suddenly dropped off, but it was still stuck to my mind. I actually can't remember when it was, when genetic algorithms were big in the news. Anyway, so the thing is, when I was first at university, one of the things that I actively worked in and I was quite enjoying was things when it comes to robotics, with things like learning machines that could learn, neural network, fuzzy logic, image processing, that sort of side of things, you know, like deep learning side of things. I was really getting into that sort of stuff. And when I left university, I did less of those sort of stuff, and I ended up focusing more on the embedded side of things for things like fuel truck and stuff like that. And so I didn't really get a chance to work in those projects anymore. So, you know, that being said, now that I finally started my own business and it's finally at a stage where it's nice and comfortable, I can finally start spending time on things that I've been dying to do, such as genetic algorithms, going back to neural network, and there's some really interesting stuff people have done with neural network that when I first was in university, there wasn't really that much of a hype, and then now around this time, there's a lot more people actively playing with that, mostly because there's a lot more libraries already built for people to play with, that sort of stuff. So it's kind of interesting. So, I finally got a chance to actually play around with genetic algorithm. I actually start writing my own and kind of playing around and couldn't get my head around it. And I was quite enjoyed it. I don't know if it's worth mentioning it, how it works, or, you know what, I'll do it anyway. I do apologize if I end up kind of screwing up the description a bit. I'll try and keep things, wasn't really planning to do this bit anyway. So what is genetic algorithm for anybody who is interested? It is something you can use to try and find a solution or an efficiency. That's not even a great way to explain it. It's a great way for you to try and find to find a solution within a set of data. So if you've got some data that have particular patterns that are hard to try and search through, then you can use something like genetic algorithm to try and narrow down to the solution, to kind of search for the solution. So I guess you can say it's a search function, a way to do that. Kind of a weird way to do it if you're trying to search for a set of data, because it kind of relies you to kind of have some understanding what the solution needs to be to try and get a good understanding how to implement the, I guess you can say, the fitness, but I'll talk more about that in a second anyway. So the way it works is the genetic algorithm is modeled more like evolution. So you've got a set of nodes, which is like people, and then you are essentially going through tasking each of those nodes or the people, population, maybe the best way to explain it because that's the correct term to use. You're basically tasking the population to go out and do something. And you basically created some sort of, each person or each node has some sort of DNA makeup or some sort of configuration that they rely on to try and make decision to do and find your solution. And what you do is that at the end of a period, a generation, you then basically go through each of those nodes or each of those people within the population to try and determine who's been the most successful at finding the solution. They might not have found the solution yet, but maybe they've gotten close to it. And what you then do is you take the ones that have been most successful and you cross their DNA or their configuration with the other nodes within the population to try and get them to be better. So you create new children within those old generation to create new children for the next generation to try and search for your solution. So you discard the old and you've created a new set of children and you send them off again another generation and try and see how well they succeed. And at the end of that generation, again, you repeat the same thing. Again, you check to see which other nodes have been the most successful, and then you then go and tell them, okay, you've been most successful, you get to be bred more often than the rest, and therefore you know your goodness or your makeup, your DNA that makes you be most successful at finding the problem gets crossbred to the rest. Now, that's fine, but if you just do that, then you're actually just going to end up getting to a stale situation, because if you imagine people constantly inbreeding and never introducing anything new to the DNA, then you are essentially going to end up getting the best of what you started out with in the first place. So your initial generation, your initial population, their DNA, if one of them happened to be slightly better than the rest, then you are slowly breeding everything to become that. So every time you breed, or every time you crossbreed the DNA of the most successful to the least successfuls, you want to try and add some mutation, some random changes to their DNA. Not too much, but just enough so that you're actually trying to increase the chances of them slowly evolving to a better solution. Now imagine if, for example, you added a mutation that actually makes the node worse. Well, that one will end up getting less successful at finding the final product, and therefore won't be bred to the rest as often. Where if you were to introduce a mutation that actually happens to have increased the better chance, or happen to increase the performance of a particular node, then that particular node, if it's been more successful, they end up getting bred to the rest and introducing that mutation to everybody. So therefore, or all the nodes, I should say, so therefore, that generation will get a better chance, or the new generation will get a better chance of finding the product, and slowly but steady that happens. So every time, your mutation is what's slowly helping the system get to the final answer. Now, I probably should point out, so things like the way you judge how successful a node has made it to the solution, that's called a fitness. The way you mix the DNAs, that's called a cross, or your crossbreeding or cross function. Then the mutation, you're just adding random stuff. But there's a few issues. So there's actually quite a few problems that I actually found with this algorithm. First of all, I want to make it clear, genetic algorithm isn't what teaches the machine. It isn't the thing that machines use to learn. It is the thing that the machines use to try and find a better way to do something. So it would aid the machine, for example, if you wanted to use it for that, it would aid it to try and learn better, to find the better solution of whatever it's learning. But it isn't the thing that machines actually are, what makes it the learning machine. So you usually have to use genetic algorithms with other things, for example with neural networks or even in the simplest way, for example the simplest way to look at it is like, if you got this traveling salesman issue, if you've ever heard of that, travel salesman problem is where you've got somebody who has to go and see multiple clients in a particular route, and it needs to try and figure out the best route to get to all of them and to minimize waste of time, and also to be able to hit all of them within a certain time period. So you code up the algorithm that tells the travel salesman how to get around. But trying to find the right route, then you would use the genetic algorithm to plan that out. So the thing that actually teaches the salesman, I guess in this case, how to get to all the clients in a particular route, it's that algorithm plus the genetic algorithm of selecting which route has been the most successful that gives it the learning, the learning side effect, I would say. The thing that actually makes it learn is when you combine the two together. Kind of sounds really weird. I do hope that kind of makes sense. Now, there is quite a few issues that I found with the genetic algorithm. And one of them is that first, like I think I'm sure I mentioned it earlier, you have to have a good understanding of you have to actually have some idea what the final product is going to be or the final solution, so that you actually have a better chance of creating a fitness value or creating or judging how well a particular node has made it to the final answer. Because if you don't really understand the data, like for example, you decide to say, okay, I've got a bunch of data that I just logged from an accelerometer, and I don't really know what the signal is meant to look like when somebody is humming on the background when the sensor is on, for example. If you don't really know what that's supposed to look like, you've not even gone through the effort of actually looking at the signal to see what you're expecting, then it's going to be hard for you to actually create a fitness value or a fitness code that judges how well the nodes have been successful. Which brings up to the next issue that I found with the genetic algorithm, and that is, when do you end it? When do you say stop? Because the thing is, genetic algorithm isn't a replacement for exact answers. If you want to get an exact value for something, an exact answer, then you're better off writing code to search for that. You're better off writing a code that actually searches for the data and actually extracts the data for you. For example, if you got a database full of data points from your accelerometer, then you're better off writing code saying, okay, I am looking for any acceleration that's greater than this. So there's really no point of you trying to use genetic algorithm to search through all the data and try and find the best answer that way, because genetic algorithm tend to give you more like a scale of an answer, like the likelihood an answer being the right one. Like for example, it's better at giving you numbers between 0 to 1, any numbers between that, obviously if you use the floating points. So if the answer is within that range, then genetic algorithms are great for searching for stuff like that, but they're not so great when you can't just get the exact answer. For example, is today, the efficiency that you're wasting on genetic algorithm is nowhere near, it's you're better off writing code that actually gives you an exact answer if you know what you're expecting at the end. So for example, like if you're trying to teach a robot, well, actually no, that's not really the best example, but I think hopefully you understand what I mean. The point is the termination function, what tells you that you finish your generation, when have you reached the final answer? That's the issue. If you don't know what the final answer is going to be, you're just going to get something that's close. You may not necessarily get the actual best answer. You might get the closest answer. Maybe you got lucky. Maybe you decided to leave the your code running continuously until finally, after 10, 20 years, it's finally found an answer that can't be any better than what anybody else has received. And yeah, there we go. So that's what I'm trying to get at. So the thing is, because with genetic algorithm, you're constantly going through generation after generation, creating a new population based on the old, and you're kind of slowly doing that, it takes time. It's not that efficient, and it's going to be a pain of you trying to get to the final answer. Sometimes if the problem is easy, then it's not a problem. Sometimes the actual act of searching for the data is actually the fun bit, the bit that you actually want to use. For example, there's a very good video on YouTube by Daniel, I think it's Shiffman, where he basically coded a code challenge, and I'll put that on the show notes, the video for it. And his code challenge was to try and create smart robots using genetic algorithm to teach them to get to the target. Although technically the genetic algorithm in this case was trying to find the best answer. Genetic algorithm doesn't actually teach, the way he set it up, the genetic algorithm wasn't actually teaching the rockets to find the target. They were teaching them to find a good path from an existing problem. So if you actually wanted to send off the rocket going off in on its own to try and search it on its own, like a mace, and the mace is constantly moving, the target is constantly changing into places, then you're probably better off rewriting the code. But in his example, it's very good. Your problem is you've got a rocket, the target is fixed, and you need to try and find the best path from A to B. There's things going to be in the way that might make it harder for them. And with his implementation of genetic algorithm, all the rockets slowly but steadily started finding and verging to the correct, well, to a path that made sense. Now, I actually went ahead and tried to replicate his code, because there were a few things I wanted to try out, and mostly because I was in the whole, you know, genetic algorithms, everything I need to try kind of thing. And the funny thing is, like, the way I had it set up is that I actually had it generating random blockades, things that ended up blocking the rocket's path to get to a particular problem. And there were times that I was looking at the randomly generated map that I was thinking, actually, this looks impossible for those rockets to get from A to B. But then suddenly, yeah, they made it through, and they got to the target in a way that I didn't expect it. And then when you dig into the code, you realize actually the reason why they were able to squish into a particular point is that there's just enough pixel distance between the two targets for the rocket to just about squish in there without causing any collision between the targets, the blocks. Another place, the barricades. That's probably a better explanation. Anyway, enough about that. So I would definitely encourage you to try and give that a try. I will link into Daniel's video so you can have a look at that if you are interested. It is JavaScript that is used using the P5 library. So if you are wanting to get into JavaScript, this is probably not the one to get into. But he does do a lot of good videos explaining JavaScript and P5 library for implementing animations and stuff like that on HTML5 and all that sort of stuff. So I would definitely recommend giving that a try. At least if you do have time, whatever language you want to do, try and implement some sort of genetic algorithm, do have a look at his video. Even though you might not try JavaScript, or it might not be the language you want to use, at least on his video you're actually able to kind of figure out the fundamentals of how genetic algorithms work. And I do believe he actually has written a book on the subject, and that neural network and all that stuff anyway. So if you are actually finding machines that learn, deep learning and all that sort of stuff interesting, sign up to his video anyway. I mean, I have anyway. It's pretty good. All right, that is it for me. Enough with my mumbling. I just realized that I've been talking for over 40 minutes or so. So that's it for me. If you want to be sociable with me, I am on Twitter. My username is OpticalWorm. For this podcast, the username, the Twitter account for that is #DefineItLec. Do head over to YouTube, sign up to that if you want to see my face and the room I'm in. I've tried to make it look a little bit nicer than that. I'm still playing with the format anyway. If you want to leave me any comments, there are comments below on both on YouTube and on the on the site that I published this podcast as well. You can go over there and leave me comments. If you have any questions, stuff like that, you can always go to Twitter. That's a good place to speak to me. Oh, and one final thing, I actually do publish this podcast, the audio form. I might start doing the video over Hackaday.io. So if you are actually part of there, don't forget to go over and subscribe to me, and you get to see my other projects anyway. That's it for me. So see you later. Bye.